We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard.
Now, Mr. Fraser, was there one time that Mr. Oswald asked you to drive him back to Irving that was not on a Friday?
Yes, sir, he did.
Was that on November the 21st, 1963, a Thursday?
Yes, sir.
The day before President Kennedy was assassinated?
Yes, sir.
And what did you say to him?
He asked me, could he ride home? And I said, sure, you can ride home with me anytime. And then I thought, and I said, well, why do you want to go home with me tonight? And he told me that he was going home to get some curtain rods for his apartment from Miss Payne.
Okay, so that evening after work, you brought Mr. Oswald back to Irving, is that correct?
That's correct.
Yes, he came out that night, and it was the first night he'd come out on a weeknight, and it was the first time he'd ever come without asking permission.
And you were surprised?
I was very surprised, yes.
Was Marina a little embarrassed and surprised that...
She was, yes. She said to me, she apologized for his not asking whether he could come, and she expressed her surprise.
To the best of your recollection, when did you first see him that Thursday evening?
I saw him, it was about 5:30 in the evening. I had just gotten back from grocery shopping, and he was already there. They were on the front lawn talking when I arrived.
Well, he come to me the Thursday, November the 21st, and asked me could he ride home with me that afternoon. And I said, well, yes. And I said, well, why are you going home this afternoon? And he replied that he wanted to go home and pick up some curtain rods where he could put some curtains up in his apartment. And I said, oh, very well. And then I said, well, will you be going home with me tomorrow also? And he said, no. He said he wouldn't be going home with me on the 22nd.
So he told you that he wanted to come out there and pick up some curtain rods, and this was on Thursday morning?
Yes, sir.
And at that time, he told you that he would not ride home with you Friday night.
Right.
Dallas didn't vote for Kennedy in 1960 and may not endorse him in 64. That isn't going to in any way affect the warm reception they're going to get. Like Times Herald said last month, we're going to be genial hosts. You agree with that, Mary Lou?
You bet.
Oh, look. Lee's gone off in the... his wallet behind. It's his wedding ring.
I looked out the window and saw a man, whom I learned later was Mr. Oswald, crossing the street with a package approximately 2.5 feet long. He proceeded across my carport, and I opened the door to see where he was going and saw him put the package into my brother's car.
Minutes later, he is joined by Fraser.
I went out the back door. Lee was standing just outside the door. We walked to the car. As we were getting in the car, I saw the package, and I said, what's the package, Lee? And Lee said, curtain rods.
Thank you.
fixed to shut the door, he started walking a little bit faster, and he finally got about 50 feet ahead of him.
Unlovely amid Dallas's splendid downtown structures, the depository is a textbook distribution center. Oswald's job, gathering books for shipment to Texas schools, gives him access to the building's 7 floors.
By 10 o'clock, on the outside of the building, some people had gathered. And he asked me what was they gathering around out there for. And I told him that the president was supposed to come by that morning. And he asked me what time, and I didn't know what time it would be, but some of the people there started gathering around. And he asked me which way would the president be coming. And I told him. And so he said, oh, yeah. And I said, yeah. Then he turned around and walked off.
I looked directly across and up, possibility at a 45 degree angle. And this man, same man I had saw prior to the president's arrival, was in the window and taking aim for his last shot. After he fired the last or the third shot, he didn't seem to be in a great rush, hurry. He seemed to pause for a moment to see if for sure he accomplished his purpose. And he brought the gun back to rest in upright position as though he was satisfied.
What did you say to him?
I just said, fella, at lunchtime, you going downstairs? And he said, no. He said, close the gates on the elevator when you get out.
We'll be right back.
got on the bus and paid his fare. And I wouldn't be positive, but I believe that he sat down on the second seat on the right-hand side of the bus there. Eddie, we reached this point here, traffic had come to a standstill. At the same time, the gentleman that I picked up back up at Murphy Street back here, in other words, he got up and came up and got him a transfer and got off at the same time.
A young white man, he had seen the rifle disappearing from that window after the shots were fired. And a Dallas newsman, Mel Couch, said he was riding shortly behind the president in the parade. He said after the shots were fired, he happened to look up at about the fifth or sixth floor of the Texas Book Depository. He said he saw the rifle being pulled back in.
Changed my clothes, got my pistol, and then I went to a movie.
Why do you carry a pistol?
Well, you know how boys are when they have a gun. They just carry it.
Out of the 500,000 or so people in Dallas, Lee Harvey Oswald is the one out of those 500,000 people who just happens to murder Officer J.D. Tippit. Oswald's responsibility for President Kennedy's assassination explains why he was driven to murder Officer Tippit. The murder bore the signature of a man. Desperate flight from some awful deed. What other reason under the moon would he have had to kill Officer Tippit?
He walked into the lobby of a store.
How far in did he walk out there, John?
Well, just a few feet. He was standing right where those tennis shoes are right there, just about 5 feet from the door there.
What made you suspicious of this man who walked into the lobby?
Well, right after the president had been shot, they broadcast an inscription on the radio. This man was 5'8", 5'9", 150 pounds, and this Oswald matched the description. And
seemed to make sure that they had gone by and then stepped out on back onto the sidewalk and walked up toward the Texas Theater.
How far is the Texas Theater from your store?
It's in the same block.
I walked up to the aisle, I turned into the aisle, I said, get on your feet. And he stood up immediately. He brought this right hand up to his chest.
Did he say anything when you...
As he was bringing his hands up, he brought the other one up to eye level. He said, well, it's all over now. At that time, I was reaching this way, and his hand got in front of mine, owned a pistol. My hand grabbed the pistol in this manner, and he hit me with that left hand to the nose. And when he did, I came back and hit him like this. He slapped the pistol. I turned the pistol around, and I got my hand on the butt. Came over like this. I was holding him with this hand. I handed this pistol to an officer that was out in the aisle.
Nobody move. All of you stay where you are.
What's going on? An officer named Tippett's just been killed.
Is that the guy who did this here?
That's him. Right there.
Get up. Well, it's all over now.
Get his gun. Get it.
All right.
He's got a gun.
I'm not resisting arrest. I'm not resisting arrest. Police brutality. Police brutality. I'm not resisting arrest. I am not resisting arrest. Police brutality. Police brutality.
Lee, would you submit to a polygraph or lie detector test?
Well, I refused to take a polygraph test from the FBI when I came back from Russia. I'm sure not going to take one now from the Dallas police.
And have such an ulterior motive for putting me in a position I'm in. We'll never let the true facts come above board to the world.
Now, these people are in very high positions, Jack.
Yes.
I'm
all right. Don't worry about me.
I don't know. Что должен делать Ли?
Nothing. Don't do anything yet. You can always take the children and go back home to Russia.
No, а что ты?
Nothing's gonna happen to me.
But how can you know that, Ли?
Because I know it.
At this point, if we had nothing else, how much do you need? If we had nothing else, this would be enough to prove Oswald's guilt beyond all reasonable doubt. But there's so much more. And where did you examine the documents?
In the National Archives in Washington, D.C.
Exhibit 167. Now on the screen is a photograph of a Klein's sporting goods order form for a 6.5mm Mannlicher Carcano rifle with a telescopic sight and an envelope addressed to Klein's store dated March the 12th, 1963. Is this one of the question documents you examined?
Yes. I identified all of the handwriting on the envelope, including the A. Heidel return address and the writing on the clipping for the order for the rifle as being the handwriting and handprinting of Lee Harvey Oswald.
So Oswald wrote the word or the words or the name A. Heidel, is that
yes,
correct?
Yes, he did.
Did you look at a photograph of two damaged bullet fragments, but two bullet fragments found front seat of the limousine?
Yes, I did.
Your panel conducted a comparison microscope examination of these two fragments?
Yes, we did.
And the findings?
Findings were that each of the fragments were fired through the rifle, or the Oswald rifle.
Was it your finding that the Connelly stretcher bullet was fired from Oswald's Carcano rifle to the exclusion of all other weapons?
That is true.
Three expended cartridge casings found on the floor right beneath that sixth floor window. Undoubtedly the same casings that Mr. Norman heard fall from above. Were fired in and ejected from Oswald's rifle to the exclusion of all other weapons. So we know, not just beyond a reasonable doubt, we know beyond all doubt that Oswald's rifle was the murder weapon that caused that terrible, terrible spray of brain matter to the front. The worst sight that I've ever seen in my entire life.
The policeman walked to the, got to the, even to the front wheel on the driver's side, and this man shot him in the wink of your eyes. Just bang, bang, bang.
And the door opened, he come in a hurry. Now, who knew in a hurry? He never parted his lips and went to his room, got a short coat put on, and went out and to the bus stop. And that's the last I saw of him.
Looking at Lee Harvey Oswald, is he or is he not the man that you saw that day?
That's the man, yes, sir.
Any question in your mind about that, sir?
None whatsoever.
Okay, you may sit down. That murder bore the signature of someone in desperate flight from some awful deed. 30 minutes later, he pulls a gun on the arresting officer. During the interrogation process, he tells one
provable lie after another.
You were in the Marines, weren't you?
Yes, I was.
You ever win any medals for marksmanship?
Just the usual.
Do you own a rifle?
No.
That's a rifle, isn't it? And that's you holding it, isn't it? No.
What do you mean, no? That's you. That's your face.
I worked in a photo plant. I know how you can fake pictures. It's my head on somebody else's body.
You still insist this is part of a cover-up? That we're making this whole thing up?
I don't know about you for sure, but I know somebody's trying to railroad me on this.
He definitely was not an enemy. He was an admirer of President Kennedy. And we raised that question several times. With me, he was extremely sincere. Because I treated him almost like a son of mine, you know. He could have been a son by his age. Or as a soldier in my regiment.
Did you ride to work with Wesley Fraser on Friday morning?
Yes.
At that time, did you carry a package which you told Mr. Fraser contained curtain rods?
No, I don't recall having such a package.
Well, did you have any package with you?
Just my lunch, which was in a sack.
What was the size and shape of that sack?
I don't remember if it was a large sack or a small sack. I mean, you don't always get the right size sack to fit your sandwiches.
Where did you place that sack when you got into the car?
On my lap, or beside me. I didn't want to get it crushed.
Mr. Fraser has stated that you placed a long package in the back seat.
Well, he must be mistaken, or he's thinking about some other time maybe that he picked me up.
What floor were you on when the president was shot?
I was on the first floor eating my lunch.
And what floor were you on when the police officer stopped you right after the shooting?
On the second floor, in the lunchroom. I'd gone up to get a Coke.
Why did you leave the building after that?
Well, with so much excitement going on and all the confusion, I didn't think there'd be any more work for the rest of the day.
Where'd you go when you left work?
Went to my rooming house.
Where'd you eat that lunch you brought with you?
I told you, on the second floor.
Well, yesterday you told us you ate on the first floor.
Well, I ate on both floors.
Did you eat alone?
No, I ate with some of the colored boys. I think one of them's name was Junior. The other was a little short man.
Junior who?
I never knew his last name.
They were there the same time I was. I saw them leave the lunchroom. Ask them.
We just did. They didn't see you in the lunchroom.
As surely as I am standing here, as surely as night follows day, Lee Harvey Oswald, acting alone, is responsible for the murder of President John F. Kennedy. You are 12 reasonable men and women, and that is why I have every confidence that you will confirm this fact for the pages of history by your verdict of guilty. Thank you so very much, ladies and gentlemen.
You may be seated. Counsel, if you would please, if you'd please stand. I'll ask Mr. Nelson, if he would, to please read the verdict.
Verdict. We, the jury, find the defendant Lee Harvey Oswald guilty of the offense charged in one of the indictment.